Hey, everybody, I'm your host, Gene Marks, and this is season two of the Paychex Business Series podcast. As you know, I am a certified public accountant, a regular business columnist for a bunch of publications you may know, like The Guardian and The Hill and The Washington Times and The Philadelphia Inquirer. But most importantly, I'm a small business owner of a financial and technology management services company. I've teamed up with Paychex, the leading provider of human resources, payroll, benefits, and insurance services, to bring you real-life stories and advice from real-life business owners and experts. Now, last season, we talked about the challenges associated with COVID-19, and this season, we're focusing on moving forward and innovating and navigating the road to recovery. Now, I mentioned before that I write in a bunch of different places, but let's be clear. I am a contributor to these places. I am not a paid journalist. That is another profession with a different level of professional expertise that I don't even profess to have. But my guest today does have that expertise. His name is Zachary Warmbrodt. Zach has covered financial services for Politico since 2020. His reporting focuses on Washington's relationship with Wall Street and the broader finance industry, including banks, insurers, and asset managers. I got acquainted with Zach on Twitter, just following all of his posts and his commentary on a lot of the things that are affecting small businesses. And what I wanted to have Zach talk about today is a little bit about his job and what he does. And as business owners ourselves, I think we ought to know the people that are writing and providing us information and have a better understanding as to where they're coming from, so we can have a better sort of understanding of the stuff that they write about. So Zach, thank you for joining me. I'm glad that you're here.
Thank you so much for having me.
So first of all, Zach, tell me what your job is at Politico. What do you do?
Sure. So I cover financial services at Politico. And so what that means at our organization, so Politico, we started as, political news driven organization, web-based. That was kind of our claim to fame is, we did the web better, in the mid 2000s than some of the legacy media organizations did. And so a few years into that, we launched a service called Politico Pro, which is a subscription service that is kind of broken up in different policy areas. So to get into the real nitty gritty of what Congress is doing, what financial or what regulators are doing, and so I'm on the financial services team. So we cover financial regulation. So that could be banking, the Securities and Exchange Commission, the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, and what Congress and the White House are doing in all those areas. And so my specific niche is I cover a lot of what's happening in Congress, specifically as it relates to banking.
So what is your background? Like, how are you prepared to do this?
I'm from Texas originally. I went to the University of Texas at Austin. And I pretty much quickly knew as soon as I got there, I wanted to focus on journalism. And so I worked at the student paper and I kind of figured out I wanted to focus on business reporting. I read a lot of the Wall Street Journal and, Financial Times and things like that. And I really wanted to go down that route. So that's what I started off as. I didn't really initially plan to be covering politics or be in Washington. I was working in Texas covering the oil and gas industry. And then after the financial crisis, under the Obama administration, there was a big rewrite of financial industry rules and regulations. And so when that happened, there was an opportunity for me to come up here to Washington to cover how that was rolling out. And that's what I've been doing ever since, focusing on the intersection of, the financial industry and Washington.
You have worked at, I've been on your LinkedIn. You're an intern at the Dallas Morning News. You're at Argus Media for 4 years. You had been a reporter and it worked your college paper. So you've spent your life in journalism, right? So, and I know that you're also, you majored in both journalism and economics in college. Is that right?
That's right. The major was journalism, and it was what they call a concentration in economics.
Got it. Okay. So I'm going to immediately write that off only because I was an economics major in college and I don't know nothing about economics. So I mean, what we learn in college is kind of, you know, like very periphery to the actual real world. But, you know, Zach, like, you know, so you've never run a business. You've never worked at a bank. You know what I mean? You're not an attorney that specializes in security law, but you cover this stuff. So first of all, did you find that overwhelming to do? And that's my first question. And my second part to that question is, how do you then respond to people in the industry that do this for a living, that you know what you're talking about, when, you know, you have a different expertise? Your expertise is in journalism. Do you follow what I mean?
Yeah, that's a great question. And I think it's kind of really important for people to hear about that process. And I guess maybe one more bit about my background. My parents have actually been small business owners. That's what they did, raising me. So my mom is still running a shop out in Dallas. But anyway, I guess on the kind of the workflow and the professional side of things for me, I think what's really important for a journalist is to have a real strong curiosity, because I think that kind of drives you to ask questions and want to study up on things you're covering. And, you know, you also kind of need to have the ability to bug people and ask questions that, you know, may be really stupid, but are really important to ask, just so you have a fundamental understanding of whatever it is you're covering. And so I think, yeah, my kind of natural curiosity about things, especially in the business world, and my ability to be really annoying and bug people and get them to talk to me, I think those have helped a lot. And it is a challenge. I mean, especially, writing about, the Paycheck Protection Program, like I've been doing, since March, it's really, taking a lot of time to understand, okay, when a variable in this program has changed, how is that going to actually affect a small business balance sheet? Or how is that going to impact the work a CPA is doing, or what a lender is doing? And so, it's hard to, it's a challenge to get it right every day, especially when you're on deadline. But, you just have to figure out the right people to talk to and what you're supposed to read. And I think you eventually get there. And then if you make mistakes, you have to own up and make a correction if it happens.
I mean, do your editors help? Do they know what they're doing, or are they relying on you really to be the feet on the ground person?
No, luckily, we have a really good team of editors at Politico who are very much veteran journalists, including, business journalists, Wall Street Journal, Bloomberg, kind of the major business publications. And so I think, I feel good, just to tout Politico, that they've invested in people who have that expertise. But again, my editor is depending on me to know the ins and outs of something like the PPP. So, it is kind of, I'm helping kind of bring him up to speed along, because he can't be doing all the same research I'm doing, to your point. But,
when you're doing your reporting, is most of it done remotely? Are you mostly on the phone or by email, or is there any feet on the ground stuff?
So before COVID-19, I was spending pretty much every day during the work week up on Capitol Hill. That was kind of my specialty, was, you kind of figure out where lawmakers are going to be, what meetings and hearings they're coming in and out of, and you try to catch them and, talk about what's on the agenda and what's coming. But obviously we haven't been able to do that. We've only been able to do it in a limited capacity, I guess. We still have some reporters up on Capitol Hill, but it's very limited, for safety reasons. And so, yeah, it's been all remote, since March. And, luckily, everyone else is at home too, for the most part. So it's actually helped in getting people on the phone or to respond to an email. And,
Zach, obviously, in this, throughout the past few years, there's been a lot of scrutiny on the journalism industry. And there's been a lot of changes in the industry as well because of that. Again, you are a journalist. You've been in this industry your entire life. What are your thoughts on the people that criticize the media? Do you think that they're completely wrong? Do you think that they just don't understand? How do you respond when people criticize the media today?
I mean, so I think if you work in the media and you're trying to bring facts to people, I think you have to be prepared, you know, to face that scrutiny. You know, especially, you know, you want people to read what you're writing and kick the tires. And like I said before, if it's inaccurate, you want to own up to that and correct it. Because at the end of the day, it's not really about you. It's about, you know, informing your readers and helping people with their lives. I mean, I think there is a line that, you know, increasingly is being crossed, you know, where, you know, people in power, you know, even when it comes to something accurate that they may not like, they'll try to label it as fake news. And I do think that has a potentially harmful effect. And I do worry sometimes that it could erode trust in the press, but I think that just means, you know, reporters, they have to keep doing what they're doing, which is, you know, trying to report accurate information and hold people accountable. And I kind of just think it makes it even more important to do that.
Fair enough. So I get asked this question a lot, and I have to ask you as well. I mean, other than Politico, which is where you work, when you're looking for news, where do you go? What resources do you turn to that you feel will give you either an unbiased view or just a thorough view of the information that you're, you know, investigating?
Sure. So I guess, you know, like you and probably many others, I mean, my kind of first resource these days is Twitter. I mean, I've kind of cultivated a very large list of people I follow who are, you know, experts like yourself or public figures or just interesting people out there in the world who have, you know, very specific point of views that I think are good indicators of the way things are going. So that's one. I mean, that's one screen. And obviously, I'm not doing any reporting, you know, it's based on Twitter. But that's kind of my first line of defense. And, you know, in terms of other publications, like I said, I, you know, read the Wall Street Journal and Financial Times and Washington Post and New York Times.
You know, it's funny because you talk about Twitter, and it is a source of hearing conversation going on. But again, you know, I mean, Pew Research found that 80% of, you know, the people in this country don't regularly use it. So it's really a, you know, 1 in 5 Americans are regularly on Twitter. So it's one source, you know, but obviously not the be all and end all. I'm glad to hear that you're not doing any reporting from there, obviously. But you know, I'm thinking of like, I don't know if you do the same, like I find Reuters to be very good for relatively unbiased news. I find, AP News, you know, Associated Press, I go to their website, and I find some unbiased, you know, fairly unbiased news there as well. But then you're mentioning of going to the New York Times and Washington Post and the Wall Street Journal. Those news sources obviously slant either right or left. But I think it's important to look at those. I mean, they're the cream of the crop as far as media, but then we'll also provide you with differing points of view. And I think that's good for a journalist, right?
So, I mean, I think my bigger point is to read everything you can. Right. And, you know, I think I would quibble about, you know, whether those are slanted. I mean, I think they try to be nonpartisan in their news operations. I think, you know, they're obviously their editorial pages are a different story. And I read those too. You know what I mean? Because you want to know, I mean, at least for a journalist, I just think you have to read as much as you can. And it has to be people that may not, especially people who, you know, are not, you know, the ones that are front of mind for you every day. I just think you need to see everything.
Fair enough. Okay. Well, listen, we only have a few minutes left and I actually wanted to just get your thoughts on just a couple of things. I know you cover banking as well and finance. You know, the banking industry itself came under a lot of, you know, a lot of criticism for the rollout of the Paycheck Protection Program. Many of them have recovered. What is your opinion of the banking industry and how it has survived and navigated its way around COVID? Do you believe that it is still, you know, a strong source of financing for small businesses as it was years ago? Or do you feel that its sort of influence and has eroded with all the other different options for financing nowadays?
Yeah, that's a great question. And that's really a big overarching issue we look at. I mean, I think for starters, you know, you just have to look at how different this crisis is for those financial institutions than, you know, the experience they went through in 2008. So, you know, this is a crisis where they aren't the source of the problems right off the bat. And so I think many of them saw it as an opportunity, especially the ones that, you know, had taken bailouts and had really kind of been beat up politically, back in the 08 crisis. I mean, I think it was kind of an opportunity for them in Washington to show they could step forward and be a source of strength in the economy. And I mean, and you've seen steps, you know, to do that. I mean, you can look at the PPP numbers, you know, more than 5 million loans, you know, those were all made by, you know, banks and other financial institutions. But then if you look through that lens, you see, you know, potential problems, a lot of those loans were made by, you know, competitors to banks, you know, fintech companies, you know, and sometimes in partnership with the banks, but, you know, it kind of showed how there's this kind of growing ecosystem of lenders outside of your traditional, you know, Bank of America's and JP Morgan's and community banks. This is also, I think the whole pandemic, the whole economic fallout, and this also ties back to PPP, has showed, you know, if you look at kind of the issues around, you know, racial discrimination and lending, and you know, the lack of access to the financial system that many people in our country still have. I mean, those problems have really become even clearer during this downturn. And if you look at kind of the operations of something like the PPP. So I do think that there have been some problems that have come to light for banks that are going to, you know, probably be addressed for years during this. But overall, we're not in a situation where I think any of them are going to fail or are in dire financial straits. So that's probably a positive sign for the economy.
That is, you know, you mentioned about, you know, fintech and the rise of fintech. You know, I mean, I see this continuing trend of more partnership between banks and software companies. Do you think that, I'm just curious to hear what your thoughts are, that we are going to see a trend in the future of more banks buying up software companies and just providing accounting software to their clients. Do you see that as happening in the future?
I don't know specifically about accounting software, but I do think you're right. You're going to see more of these mergers or acquisitions by banks, you know, with these financial technology companies. You know, American Express, I think, recently acquired Cabbage, you know, which is one of the fintech lenders. And then I do think, you know, a lot of these banks want to bring that expertise in-house because they are, you know, they want to keep their customers, you know, who are mostly migrating, you know, who are migrating to mobile banking. They want to keep them and continue offering them services. And then, you know, there's also a competition issue here because now we're seeing some, you know, more straight up, you know, technology companies dip their toes into finance. Like, you know, Facebook is, and some partners are working on launching their own, you know, cryptocurrency. So this is a huge area of coverage for us, is this competition. And then also kind of symbiosis you're seeing with banking and technology.
Yeah. Another topic for another day, but I think we're going to be seeing a lot more of technology companies and other non-traditional banks continue to offer banking services. And banks are going to have to be nimble as to what they do to keep their small business customers. Final question, Zach. Your Twitter handle is @Zachary. So were you like the third user on Twitter to get that Twitter handle? Or do you have like an uncle that works there?
You know, I think I was actually a few hundred. I don't think I was a few hundred or thousand in, but not quite the third. But I'll just say I was a big tech geek around the time Twitter launched. So
yeah, that is an awesome Twitter handle. You should keep on that. And when you get, if you ever get rid of it one day, you should sell it you can retire at that point.
I wish.
Zach Warmbrodt is covered financial services for Politico since 2012. His reporting focuses on Washington's relationship with Wall Street and the broader finance industry, including banks, insurers, and asset managers. You can find him at the very coveted name of @Zachary on Twitter, Zachary. Zach, thanks a lot for joining me. We'll have a few more conversations in the future where we can dig into the next administration, how it's going to impact businesses, as well as I have more questions for you on banking. We're just running out of time. For further information and for more great podcast episodes from the Paychex Business Series podcast and other information to help you run your business, please visit paychex.com/works, W-O-R-X. I'm Gene Marks. Thanks for listening, everyone, and we'll see you again soon.
This podcast is property of Paychex, Inc., 2020, all rights reserved.